we will talk about representation of vectors. So we'll discuss graphical and algebraic representation of vectors. So let's first discuss graphical representation because it's much easier to understand. So we'll start with an example. So let's say there's a car and that car is moving at 55 miles per hour, 45 degrees from east. Okay, so this would be a graphical representation. You would draw basically a directed arrow, you would show some angle from some reference line. In this case, it happens to be horizontal, but doesn't have to be. So this is a graphical representation. Now, graphical representations are okay to look at, but they're not so convenient to deal with if you want to do any kind of algebra with them. So you're talking about adding vectors, subtracting vectors, maybe multiplying vectors, and things like that. So graphical representations are okay, but you know, not very useful for doing what we call vector algebra. So how do we represent vectors algebraically? There are two representations. So algebraic representations. One is what we call polar representation. Polar representation. So what's a polar representation? It's a compact way of showing or writing a vector. So the same 55 miles per hour car moving in northeast direction, we want to write this. So what we would do is we would first pick a symbol, and since this is a velocity vector, I'll choose V and I'll put a half arrow. You know, sometimes people put, you know, both sided arrows, but or a bar on top, but I would choose to draw a half arrow to indicate what's the vector quantity. If you don't put a half arrow on top, that means you're saying this is a scalar quantity. Equal to is magnitude, so which is 55, times a unit vector in the direction of motion. So a unit vector, I'll call it e hat. So e hat is actually a unit vector. So let me write that. E hat is a unit vector. Unit vector definition is that its magnitude is unit, is one. Okay, so we pick the magnitude here, which tells you that the number part, and then we pick e hat, which tells you about the direction part. Okay, this is called a polar representation. You could draw it. So here's my vector V, 55 miles per hour. Okay, you could even choose a scale, something like saying that, okay, 10 miles per hour would be equal to 1 centimeter. So then you would draw a vector or a line of length 5.5 centimeter on your graph paper, on a piece of paper, okay? And then you have this angle as 45 degree, and unit vector E hat is pointing along this direction. All right? Okay, so this is a polar representation. The other representation is what we call Cartesian representation. Cartesian representation. Now, Cartesian representation depends on the fact that you can take a bunch of vectors and add them together, okay? And it doesn't matter which order you add them together, your final result will be same. So there is something called a triangle law of vector addition. So let me first discuss that. Triangle law of vector addition. So I'll first show you how this works graphically. So let's say I have three vectors. I have vector A, I have vector B, and I have vector C. Okay, and I want to add them together. So graphically, what I can do is I can draw vector A. And remember, a vector is defined by the direction and magnitude. So as long as I don't change the direction and I don't change its magnitude, which is the length of the vector, then I'm not changing anything about it, which means that I can take these vectors and move them anywhere in the space. As long as I don't change their direction and magnitude, I'm okay, because those vectors will not change as a result. And that's why we also call them free vectors. So these vectors are actually what we call free vectors. So now let me take vector B. Let's say vector B is making an angle theta B from horizontal, A is making an angle of theta A, and C is making an angle of theta C from horizontal, and everything is moving in the counterclockwise direction, just to be consistent. So I have my vector B of a certain length. What I'll do is I'll draw the tail of vector B starting at the head or the tip of vector A. So I'm going to draw vector B. Here is my vector B. Now notice that this vector B is drawn in a way so that this angle is still theta B, okay? And this is of course theta A. Then I'll draw my vector C is starting at the tip of vector B. We have to just make sure that I get my angles right. So this angle has to be theta C, and that's my vector C. Okay, so I got A and I got B and C. So if I want to add these three, A plus B plus C, then the resultant vector, let's call it D, is basically determined by the tail point of vector A and the tip point of vector C. Now you can do this construction in different ways. So you could start by first drawing vector B and then draw vector A and then C, but the law of commutativity tells you that the order of addition should not change the end result. So you will still get the same answer. So vector D is never going to change as that means it. Okay, and that's the triangle law of, you know, vector addition. Cartesian representation for a vector can be obtained by choosing what we call canonical directions, two canonical directions. So let's say I have my same velocity vector V over here, 55 miles per hour. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick two perpendicular directions. And let's say this is x-axis, this is the y-axis. Along x-axis, I will pick a unit vector I hat. Along y, I'll pick a unit vector j hat. Okay? And I'll draw perpendiculars from the tip of this vector v onto the x-axis as well as onto y-axis. Okay? These are perpendiculars. Vector v now can be written as sum of two vectors. One would be this. Let's say I'll call this to be vx because this is the wrong extension, and another vector, which I'll call Vy. Okay, so Vx plus Vy give you vector V. Now, all we have to do is write down vector Vx and vector Vy, which are along canonical directions that I picked, X and Y. So Vx, because this is right angle triangle, we know something about the magnitude of Vx. Okay, so what is the magnitude of Vx? It will be, if this angle is theta, and if this length over here is V, then the Vx itself can be written as V cosine theta, which is nothing but the length of this vector, times a unit vector along that direction. That's what we have learned from the polar representation, that any vector can be written as its length or its magnitude times a unit vector along that direction. So what's the unit vector along x direction? Unit vector along x direction is I hat. So this will be simply V cosine theta I hat. Okay, let me be consistent and just use the blue color over here. So V cosine theta I hat. Similarly, Vy would be V sine theta, because that's the length of this vector, times J hat, which is a unit vector in y direction. So that means from these two, we get V equal to V cosine theta I hat plus V sine theta J hat. Now, since V is common, let me take V outside and write this as cosine theta I hat plus sine theta J hat. And if you compare this now with your polar representation, which was 55 E hat, you can actually see what this V is and what this is. So by comparison, V would be equal to 55 miles per hour, which makes sense because that's the magnitude part, or also called speed. So when we say speed is just a scalar quantity. And E hat is a unit vector, which is cosine theta I hat plus sine theta J hat. And that is Cartesian representation for you. So let's do an example. There is a force F of 5 Newton acting on a particle at an angle of 30 degree from vertical. And I want to write its Cartesian representation in this reference frame. So I have this reference frame, X and Y, unit vector along positive X direction is I hat, unit vector along positive Y direction is J hat. Now if I ask you what is the unit vector along negative X direction, you can probably guess it, it'll be in negative I hat, and unit vector along negative y direction would be minus j hat. Okay? So we have the F, we are going to draw the perpendiculars to x and y axis. Those are the perpendiculars. So vector F can be now written as, we could say it's this vector plus this vector, right? So this is, let's say, fx, and this is fy. Okay, now what is fx? Fx is, its magnitude is, so if this is 30 degree, then fx, the length would be f sine 30, right? That's basically this. So f sine 30, let's write that, f sine 30. And that's along negative I hat direction, so this would be minus I hat plus fy. Fy is, the length of fy is f cosine 30, which is basically this length. So that's f cosine 30. And the direction is going up, so that's positive j hat. So that's your representation of f in shown coordinate system. So since we know f is 5, so we'll write this 5. So this will be minus I hat by 2, because sine 30 is 1 half, plus cosine 30 is root 3 by 2, and that's j hat. So that's the representation of f, and if you have a unit, Newton, then you can add that too. Okay, so as long as you take care of the signs correctly, you should have no problem writing vectors using Cartesian representation. Now, what I've shown you in the above couple of examples are the reference frames, which are always drawn horizontally and vertically. Okay, the axes are horizontal or vertical, but it doesn't have to be. You can pick any reference frame you want. And in fact, some of the problems, you might find that choosing a reference frame which is aligned slightly differently may be actually helpful. So let me give you an example. Let's say I have an incline, and I have a block on this incline, which is allowed to, you know, slide along the incline. Then it doesn't make much sense for us to pick our reference frame shown like this. Okay, if let's say we want to represent the velocity of this block moving along this incline, then maybe it is preferable to use a reference frame that is actually aligned with the incline, because along the x prime direction, it's a simple translation motion. It's a simple linear motion. Okay, and that motion is only along x prime. So instead of using the green xy frame, we can pick the blue x prime y prime frame to indicate the velocities. Why? Because in this case, if I want to write the velocity, which let's say is, I don't know, 5 meters per second moving downward. Okay, so let's say this block is moving in the downward direction, and I want to write this velocity in the x prime y prime frame. Velocity, let me write it v prime to indicate this is the velocity in the x prime y prime frame, is nothing but 5, and since it's moving in the negative x prime direction, and let's say this is I prime unit vector, and along this direction is j prime, the unit vector will be simply minus 5 I prime meters per second. That will be the representation in the x prime y prime frame. Okay, on the other hand, if I want to write the velocity of this write the vector representation of this velocity in the green xy frame, I have to do a little bit of math over here. Let's say this angle is known as theta. Okay, then I'm going to draw this, so which is basically this vector over here. All right, and that angle would be theta as well. Okay, so now we draw the perpendicular. So let me draw it a little bit bigger. So here's my frame, x prime. This is not x prime, sorry. This is actually only x. It's only x. And this is y. And then I have my vector v, angle theta. Okay, so draw the perpendiculars. So we can be written as this vector going from here to here plus this vector. Okay, you could also do this vector plus this vector, and you will get the same result, because remember, from the triangle of addition, it wouldn't matter what you do in this case. So what is vector v? So vector v would be equal to this length, which is what, v cosine theta. So that's v cosine theta, and that's negative I hat direction, so minus I hat, and then plus v sine theta, which is this length, and that's negative j hat direction, because we're moving downward. That would be that. Okay, so you could represent your vectors in different coordinate system, and it really doesn't matter which one you pick. Most of the time, will depend on the problem that you're solving. Now let's talk about magnitude and direction of vectors, because that's one of the things that you may have to compute at times. So magnitude and direction of a vector. So what we're saying is that we are given a vector and we have to find out what its length is, what its magnitude is, and what its direction is. Okay? So let's say the vector v is given to you as v sub x I hat in some coordinate system plus v sub y j hat. Okay? Then its magnitude indicated via something like this, you put two bars around the vector, is given as square root of v sub x square plus v sub y square. Okay, and then whatever the unit might be, maybe this is meters per second, then this will be this much meters per second. So if let's say vector v is given to you as 5 I hat plus 4 j hat meters per second, then its magnitude is square root of 5 square plus 4 square, which would be 25 plus 16, which is square root of what? 41, square root of 41, right? And that is meters per second. So you compute that, and that's the magnitude. That's all, you can say that's the speed. How do you find the direction? Well, to find the direction, you just have to look at how this is actually drawn in a coordinate system, right? So we already know that Vx and Vi are the horizontal and vertical component in the xy frame, right? So if this is the vector v, then we know that this is v sub x and this is v sub y. So we're looking for this angle theta. Now it's a simple thing to determine what this theta is, because tan theta is equal to v sub y over v sub x, which means theta is tan inverse of v sub y over v sub x. So you find that angle. But you have to be a little bit careful when you compute the angles by simply dividing the y component with the x component and then taking the tan inverse, because you could lose the signs in when you do that. So I'll give you an example. So let's say I have a vector shown like this. Okay, this is 5 meters per second length. Okay, and the vector is given to you as, I don't know, let's not say this is 5 meters per second. Actually, let me erase this. This is not 5 meters per second. We're given the complete vector. Okay, so v is given as minus 3 I hat minus 4 j hat. And this makes sense because this is negative I hat direction. This is negative j hat direction. So both the components are in the third quadrant, which it, this is indicated over here because it's minus 3 and minus 4 over here. Okay. So what's the theta? The theta would be equal to, this is the angle from horizontal. So that's theta. Theta is equal to tan inverse v sub y. V sub y is minus 4 divided by minus 3. Okay. And you do the math. And you can cancel the minus, minus becomes, you know, plus, plus, and you get some angle, 10 inverse 4 over 3. I don't know what this would be. You know, let's say this theta is equal to, I don't know, 25 degree, okay? Now, if you simply do the math, the signs have canceled out and you get that angle is 25 degree, which means that you are saying that this vector is actually pointing at 25 degree from horizontal like this, right? But clearly that is not right because the vector is clearly in the third quadrant, okay? By neglecting the signs, by canceling them out, you actually lost that information. So you have to look at the signs of x and y component to be able to tell exactly what the angle would be. So in this case, because both of them are negative, then if you're writing a computer program, you would say, okay, if the both of them are negative, then I'm going to add 180 to it. So the actual angle theta prime, which is basically this, is equal to pi plus theta, which is 25 degree over here. So that would be the right answer. So you have to be careful when you compute the direction. Magnitude part is fairly straightforward. You take the x component, you take the y component, square them, add them together, and do the final square root, and you get your answer. Now, this can be extended to 3D as well. It just becomes a little bit, you know, clumsy. Computing the magnitude part is, of course, easy. You just take all the x, y, z components, square them, add them together, do a square root, and you get your magnitude. For getting the direction, it's not so straightforward, but you can use something called direction cosines to do that.